Good after morning, noon, day, night, and welcome back to the Game Corner. Whee! With your host,
slot machine noises.
big money. I am Maddie. You can also find me under the handle Athena.
I am Hoodin.
You are.
I don't have really a handle that's consistent among, like, across platforms and stuff.
I am Steve. I also don't really have anything going right now other than these fun conversations with everybody that happen every now and again sporadically.
They do indeed. So welcome to Steve's game room.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. It's more dedication than I've ever had to a single one of the games that I play. This thing is magnificent.
Oh, too kind.
You're gonna do your Soul Silver save file that has like 200 hours on it. Gonna do it dirty like that?
You think it takes less than 200 hours to get all this?
Yeah. It's Animal Crossing.
It's Animal Crossing. That makes me think it takes forever.
Nah.
I did have a lot of hours in that Soul Silver save. I'm so sad that I deleted it.
You had so many.
Steve, do you have any idea how long it took to get this room set up?
I think it's under 200 hours only because occasionally Nintendo tells you how many hours you have in a game.
Mm-hmm. Don't check it right now. You'll break everything.
No, I know. But the last time I had checked it, this game room has been up for a while. But the last time I checked it, I was like at 211, 215 hours. But also, you know, to be fair, it's easy to get money back in the early days of Animal Crossing before certain things were patched. And I'll leave it at that so that Nintendo doesn't come after me.
Delete your file. You say, no, yeah. You did not earn any of this.
Yeah. Hey, be cool. Come on, Nintendo. Look, I just got the rug. Come on.
Yeah, my room is absolutely pitiful. It's my house. It's a single room. I gave it away by saying my room is pitiful. But no, I think I have south of 20 hours in this game. I don't know. I think it's so cute and works as such a good backdrop for these conversations.
It's great. It's so nice.
Especially as we do this podcast remote. I don't always want to be on like camera or anything like that, so mm-hmm. You know it works out great.
Oh, come on.
I was just thinking, lights.
I was just thinking, like, man, it's so great. I don't have to press any buttons because I'm on another person's island. And then damn.
I know. That's Steve, okay. You have to make sure that your Switch doesn't go to sleep either, or you're gonna kick all of us out.
No, I'm good.
Okay.
I promise. I rotate my joysticks every once in a while.
Just for fun.
I jiggle them a little.
I just press A, because pressing A while sitting down doesn't do anything.
That's pretty good.
Oh.
I have mine undocked, so I just touch the screen.
Mm. Oh, that's also good. I also have mine undocked, but I don't do that.
Yep. Anyway, that's another behind the curtains look for our viewers. I think we did something similar in the last one.
Probably.
We can't help it.
Hey, we like to keep it real with the viewers, all
right? That's right. Are we doing this thing by the seat of our pants, the skin of our teeth? Absolutely.
Oh my gosh. Okay, something about that phrase, by the seat of your pants. Back when I was a kid, Maddie, I don't know if you remember this, but when I was a kid, our grandpa got me a skateboard.
Yes.
That had SpongeBob on the bottom of it.
Yes.
On the bottom of it. And the phrase flying next to SpongeBob while he is skating is by the seat of your pants.
I remember we had to throw that out after we used it to haul a pumpkin so rotten that it was just juice.
Oh, God. Yeah.
I also remember trying to use it to make, like, bringing the trash to the dumpster a little bit easier by like bungee cording it.
Yep.
Like the bin to the skateboard.
It did not work.
It did not, in fact.
It did not work.
The sheer amount of disrespect we threw at SpongeBob. Golly.
He was but a vessel for our garbage.
Golly. No respect in that home. None.
You still have me thinking about that gosh darn Soul Silver save now, Hoodin. I did not do anything impressive in my Pokemon saves when I was a youth.
Yeah,
the thing I remember most about that generation was hanging out in the AG Creek and like going down the little walkable path with Grammy and Grandpa when they gave us the games. Do you remember that?
Walking down the little path
when it was us four, and then I think our parents were there, and we were hanging out at one of the tables that's down there. I don't know if it's still down there. It's been a couple years since Heart Gold and Soul Silver came out.
It's been a little while.
But yeah, like there were some tables down there. I can't remember if we were like eating down there or not, or if we were just hanging out. And yeah, they had presents for us, and it was those games. And I was checking it out. It was it and like the Pokewalker that came in the box. I was so excited. I was reading the back of the game case over and over because I was so excited.
Man, yeah, back in the day when you had the game, but like it was there. You didn't have to download it or anything. It was there in your hands, but you weren't allowed to play it for whatever reason.
Yeah, because you know that with family.
That was a big thing with like, you know, you go to the store and you get the game for your home console. And then on the drive home, like you're reading the back of the game case.
Yeah.
Did you do that one, Steve?
No, not really. But I just wonder if that's why I like physical cartridges still so much.
Oh, it's huge. I'm not much
of a digital gamer, I guess, except for Steam.
Yeah. Physical media on PC for like modern PC games is kind of a dying trend, dying tradition. Yeah,
not that the cases and stuff that they ever made were really anything pretty, I guess. But I've always liked console cartridges. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm big on having physical versions of games for my Switch. You know?
Do I want to give a really hot take that may or may not alienate us from the larger gaming community?
Do it. It's what we're about.
Alienating ourselves.
Really dislike collectors that collect for the sake of collecting. And their goal is to have a complete collection.
So you hate Scott the Waz. It's confirmed.
I don't hate Scott the Waz.
That's exactly what you just said. Scott the Waz is a collector.
I hate Scott the Waz. I don't like that they do that. I'm not saying I don't get it. I'm not saying that like, oh, that's weird. I'm saying that it's... I think one of the more quintessential examples of when that becomes a problem is all of the unopened amiibos. When all I wanted was a gosh dang amiibo for my Smash for Wii U. I wanted like Fox, and I just couldn't find it because people kept buying all the amiibos at our GameStop. Continue piggybacking off of that is like they have these full game collections, but they're worth more if the game was never opened. Like it feels opulent and it feels consumerist. I don't know. Am I alone in this?
I also have a thing with collectors, just for collection's sake, just because I'm pretty big into like Magic the Gathering, and I've always enjoyed Pokemon cards. But the whole, like, buying it and, like, buying a pack, opening it, and being like, okay, how much money did I make? Like, that, I don't like that part of it. Like, if you
even if there are wasn't...
buying,
go like, for
if
it,
you're
go
buying
for it,
a pack of Pokemon cards, you should be buying them because you enjoyed, like, the Pokemon world and, like, handling the Pokemon cards and, like, that kind of thing. I don't know. That's just me personally. I always felt like the people who go out and buy hundreds of packs and then open them like on stream and is like, okay, how much money did I make? It feels like a waste of time.
To go get it PGA graded and stuff like that.
Yeah. It reminds me a little bit of the stock market.
Yeah.
And it's just like, if you're gonna do that, then just do stocks.
Man. the stock market.
You're taking away a lot of the opportunities for fun for people who just want to do it casually.
I mean, we're not even going to get into the whole trading card games being the primordial loot box. But anyway.
Yeah.
Steve, you're not giving any opinions on this. Are you trying to stay diplomatic?
No, I can't speak apparently.
Wait, that's the whole reason we're here. Hold on.
Hey, wait a second.
No, I think perhaps with what you're saying that maybe you didn't verbalize, but I think we may share the same thought. I like collector's editions if people actually like the game.
Yeah, like for the passion of it. Yeah.
Open and use, you know, the things in it.
Yeah, you gotta use them.
I don't get people who just like get it and then keep it just contained
on a shelf.
Like the difference, I guess, being maybe an amiibo, I guess, for just because I can't come up with anything off the top of my head. But yeah, it like an amiibo, if you just leave it in the box versus like actually using it and displaying it afterwards, or you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I know a lot of games do collector's editions and stuff now.
I don't like collect. And I mean, I guess I'm coming after Wood Hawker too. Wood of beat 'em ups. Like I'm coming after a lot of people like with these takes, but I get weird vibes. I get the yuckies from people that do collecting like of any kind, like friggin' like hats and baseball cards.
Oh, okay. Hold on. What about why we gotta drag hats into this?
Well, no. Like people that do like this is my hat collection, and then they just like they stay there. Oh,
like they don't use them.
Yeah.
Oh,
gotcha. Like, I get the yuckies from all kinds of collectors. Mm-hmm. I get the yuckies.
Let me clarify real quick so that I don't sound like a hat collector. I am a man who loves to wear hats, and thus I have a large collection of hats. That being said, I do not leave stickers and stuff on them. Like they are all hats that I actually wear and use. I just like having different hats to wear and use.
So whenever I
use
see
them all,
someone out in public, out in the wild, wearing a hat that's like, oh, like maybe their sports team or a cool hat. I'm like, oh, nice, cool hat. And then I see that goddamn sticker on it, and I just, oh, I get angry. And I don't even like hats. I cannot pull off hats. But I just go, oh, God, why do you do it?
Yeah, that's, I think, my biggest repulsive response is shoe collectors. Now, listen, I'm not trying to get this program absolutely hated by the masses, right? We're calling out collectors. We're just going to be calling out all types of groups of people.
True.
I don't get the whole shoe thing. Shoes are quite honestly there to be worn on your feet.
To protect
through
your
gross
feet
streets.
From the like, environment. Yeah.
Yeah, there's never been an environment that has been, yes, I would like, you know.
This is my artisanal collection of condoms through the ages.
It gives me the same vibe as like someone who will go to a restaurant, order like go to a restaurant, order a big fancy plate of like steak and potatoes and all this garnish, and then or like a really fancy dessert, and then take a picture of it and then just walk away. Like that's what it feels like to me. Like you can, I'm all for taking pictures of cool experiences that you go to. Yeah. Like if you go to a restaurant and you're like, damn, this plate looks amazing, and you like post it and share it and stuff. But if you're going to go there and spend the money on the product, you might as well enjoy it.
I have pictures from when Margo and I went to Super Nintendo Land at Universal and we got to go to the Chef Toad Cafe. Like I have pictures of that, but that's because like I like to remember being there, and that was really cool.
I literally was about to bring up you and Margo going
to
the cafe. And I was like, imagine if you ordered something and then just took that home and put it in like a case. And we're like, this was from that the experience of going to Super Nintendo World.
Yeah.
And that is from it until it got moldy and you still kept it in that case.
Yeah, and like I guess I technically brought home a souvenir. As in something that had no purpose other than to be displayed. But mm-hmm. I will say that the caveat on that is that it had to be constructed. It's like a, it's kind of like paper craft, but it was all like from these metal sheets, kind of like a, like yeah. a, like a cross between a Gundam and a paper craft thing. I think the brand is called like Metal Earth or something. And I had to make Peach's Castle and it's like really cool, but it was like a thing that I had to spend the time making and now I have it and can display it. But like, I don't know. I feel like that had utility beyond just like, here's something for me to display.
Yeah. I feel like souvenirs are different because their express purpose is to be purchased and like displayed or given as a gift, as a, as an inclusion to an experience someone else couldn't be a part of.
Oh,
right?
Now, oh man, now I've got a funky little gray area. What if you get hats or shoes or other collector's items as souvenirs from experiences? Like someone not from California goes to a Dodgers game and they get like a Dodgers hat.
I think that is a souvenir because they're not doing it for the express purpose of, oh, I'm adding this to my collection of like,
but what
I'm,
if that's their thing? I'm going though? Every time they go to a new sure. baseball stadium, they get that team's hat and they add it to their collection.
But that's the same thing as like, oh, every time I go to like this place, I get a, like, I want to get one pack of Pokemon cards for every new box that comes out. Like, it's the same thing.
I think
it's
I just found the line for myself, but I want to hear you guys keep going. But I think I found the line for myself. I found
it. What is your line?
The line for me is this collector only gets the item if they've been there. But if you're going on eBay trying to complete your collection of MLB hats in factory new condition, I think that's the line for me.
Interesting.
I think that's the line that I know that's like quite definitionally arbitrary, but I think that there's something there, you know, because if you're going out like this is, every baseball stadium I go to, every team that I go to, I get their hat. And even if like, Steve, you live over by Dodger Stadium or close enough to it to where like, that's a thing you could just go to. Like if you got a whatever the new Dodgers hat is every time you went and you had your collection of Dodgers hats, and that's besides the point, but like, you're like, oh, this is my collection of Dodgers hats. And every time I go see a game, I get a hat. Like, I think that does not give me the yuck. But if you were like, I'm collecting every version of the Dodgers hat in as good condition as I can get, I think that gives me the yuck. You know what I mean?
Yeah. If you're doing it for the express purpose of collection, not because you care about the thing.
Oh, God. Oh, what have you done?
Oh, no.
Oh, God.
The world is spinning and I have no control.
No, that's a great spot. I love it right there.
Okay.
But I think it's not even to use words like express purpose of collection, because they're both collections. They're both explicitly for collections. But I think one of them is that it is like tied to you and your experience. And the other is like an obsession.
I think you're right in that they are both for the purpose of collection. But I think for the one that you are involved in, it's a collection of not just items, but memories and experiences.
Your experiences. Sure.
It like for my, like my magic cards, I will admit I have a big collection of magic cards. I don't intend on doing anything with them besides maybe playing with them.
But you don't go online and find a meta deck and then purchase all the cards for that deck.
No. And I also am not spending hundreds of dollars every month on the magic cards, but like I can go in and for a majority of the cards be like, oh man, I remember opening this up with my friend and like thinking about, oh, how can I use this? And like actually having like a memory associated with that section of cards.
Yeah.
Like, they are important to me because I have a sentimental value to them.
I'm
going out collecting magic cards because I think I can make a profit off of them.
I found a new line. If someone was doing an estate sale and they saw your collection, if someone went, oh, that's worth a lot of money, then it gives me the yuck. But if someone goes, what is this crap? Then that's fine. I don't know, Steve, I got to hear you out. I need to know your position on this.
I don't know. I think everyone brings up interesting points to consider. I think from originally when you brought up where you thought your line was, I think mine quite simply is, if the item is meant, like if its sole or primary purpose, maybe this is getting a little too legal, is to be displayed, I think displaying it is fine and collecting it is fine. Like there's not much you can do with a snow globe, right?
True.
That being said, I don't think people should really be collecting a bunch of snow globes.
just you wait for the dozens of snow globe collectors in the comments now.
No, so I guess what I mean, part of it is like, I think I draw my line at if you keep things in their packaging, that's where I go, we've lost the spirit, right? Because after, amiibos can be used, but like once they're used, Soul Silver that often anymore. So I don't use my Pokewalker that often anymore. But if I wanted to like keep it as part of like my gaming area, you know, and kind of display it because I have it and it was a part of my life and my childhood.
Yeah.
Cool. I think that's fine. Right. Yeah. Once you start keeping things in the box, right? Like I'm not going to open my amiibo because it's only going to be in the box because that's where it retains its highest. So it's like, so you're not really using it. So it is just kind of like,
but
I don't want to say a brag piece, but it's kind of
a lot of amiibo and they have them in a glass case. Where does that land for you?
I think once again, a little bit of it pivots to intent, right?
Sure.
If you're just trying to collect all of the amiibos and you don't even play like the games that they're associated with, like you collect all of the Super Smash Bros. Amiibos because you want to collect all of the amiibos, but you don't play Smash. Yeah.
I don't even have a Switch, but I just think they're cute. It's like,
And that's very different than, let's say, I am a huge, what is that? The one with the slime, Dragon Quest?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Uh-huh.
I'm a huge Dragon Quest fan, and they now have an amiibo that technically is because of Super Smash.
Yeah, but I'm just a
fan of the game, and that's what I play. I think that's chill. You know, you want to get that amiibo, like, because it's a cool... assuming you don't buy it scalped, pretty inexpensive like piece compared to other things, you know, go for it.
And
like,
you need a personal connection to that world for it to make sense to me. Because if you're just like, oh yeah, I collect all of like any and all snow globes that I can find because I love snow globes. Like that's just a little weird to me.
eBay and search the word snow globe.
Yeah, but if you're like, man, I love Smash Bros. And I love all of the characters in it, so I have all of the amiibos, that's fine.
I think that is a phenomenal way of describing it, right? Like, amiibos by themselves, the term, has no inherent community value or meaning, right?
Yeah.
Just amiibo alone. What really it comes from is the game that it's the amiibo is for or whatever. So yeah, to your point, right, if you're just collecting snow globes as opposed to like, I want to get a snow globe of everywhere I go, so when I go to Arizona I want to find a snow globe there, you know what I mean? Okay, now we're doing something with it as opposed to I just want to collect all of the snow globes ever.
It's not item specific for me, it's intent.
Yeah,
I like that. Yeah,
I just need a purpose
for it outside of, oh, I just like collecting things.
I think that that line can get a little fuzzy. And again, like we're out here
putting collectors on blast.
The morality of collecting, but
hear me out.
Yeah,
All I gotta say is, what is the difference between a collector and a dragon that hoards its riches? You know, what purpose is it serving the dragon?
Yeah, right? Collectors other than, can't breathe fire.
Yeah.
And it just being there.
I think I want to not extend an olive branch, but to like, kind of bring this back into like, you know, the world of like recognizing that these people are people. Like, I would love to sit down with someone like Wood or another collector and like hear them out as to like, I want to know more, but I don't think that yuck is going to go away when it's like, I just want the full collection.
Like, yeah, I think it pivots back to that dragon idea of
because I know Scott's a big collector. I know what's his name? He does Spawn Wave. I'm so sorry, guy who does Spawn Wave. You make really awesome content, but I know you've been working on a GameCube collection. But I think and then you know, Wood has a whole Nintendo Switch collection. And I don't think those give me the yuck nearly as bad, because Wood is doing his collection for the Nintendo Switch, which he's talked about has been like his big break as a YouTuber. I know Spawnwave has talked about doing his GameCube collection because he said that was a really big era for him. And I know that Scott, I don't know, Scott might still give me the yuck, but no, I do. I really love Scott and Scott's content. I enjoy Scott's content from an archival standpoint and less from a looking at a collector's collection standpoint. And like, that's a really fuzzy line. But I think that also kind of gets to it, because I really care about things like game preservation and you know, how the era of like live service things. And I think the whole Angry Birds is a great like fucking crunch down version of what I'm talking about here, where like game preservation is a really big deal, and we're gonna lose a lot of games. We've lost a lot of games to them being digital only and for cell phones, and like the 3DS and Wii U eShops are great examples. Like, there's lots
Rest
and lots
in peace,
and lots
Pokemon
of
Duel.
There's so many examples, and like, so I care about preservation, I care about archiving, I care about these things. But individual collectors are not an archival organization. Like, there's a really distinct difference there, especially when you get into like things like auctions and things like that. I think that's really like outside of the line of what we're talking
yeah.
about.
So are we ready to start discussing?
Oh yeah, are we actually
halfway through the episode?
are we ready to get to the actual thing we wanted to talk about?
Hey, don't worry. I got our segue here, you guys.
Oh, give it to me.
So, on the topic of game preservation, it's interesting to see where the industry is going at the moment. It seems like there's a strong push towards sort of this streaming games kind of a service, which I think has a lot of pros and cons, right? I think it's a further step into sort of losing physical aspects that come with gaming, like discs.
Like physical ownership, actual ownership of your things.
Well, and not that the discs anymore had the actual content from the game, right? It was just like the key.
Don't get Muda started on this topic. There's some nuance here. But anyway, continue, please.
And so, well, I think one of the silver linings may very well be that in order to have a good good library to support people wanting to stream or be subscribed, I think is having content. And that's, I think, can be reassuring when we're looking at it from the perspective of, in order to keep a good catalog of games, you want to make sure the older stuff is present, right? To be able to bolster that catalog.
True. A back catalog, a library is important.
And, you know, not to keep talking, but I think we can see that from Nintendo. I think Nintendo started adding some Game Boy Color and Game Boy Advanced games to their subscription service, which I would have never dreamed of them doing ever.
It was one of those things that, like, people like Arlo and Spawnwave and Scott, like, always talked about, like, oh, you know, like, this would be a really easy ad that adds a lot of value to the service, but Nintendo would never do it because it's such an easy low-hanging fruit. They'll just never do it. And look, they did it.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's kind of cool, I think, to see I may not be a huge fan of subscription services and streaming services. Like, I don't have any of the TV related subscription services.
Yep.
But I think for gaming, it can be kind of cool. I think there's a lot of games out there to be able to access them at an affordable price, you know? It's kind of nifty, especially when, you know, maybe you don't have all of the technology, especially the stuff that's older, to play these older games, you know, that are both console scarce and game scarce. And if you do find them, they're expensive or maybe they don't run properly.
Yeah, the way our current economic system works and the way that, you know, just manufacturing works, things like the Nintendo 64, like, there's a finite supply of them in the world.
Yeah, and then maybe, too, you think you're actually getting a correct copy of Pokemon Platinum through eBay, and it turns out that it was a...
It was a bootleg.
It was a bootleg version, so it constantly freezes and crashes, you know? Not from personal experience or anything, of course, but...
No, you didn't. Someone in this group didn't go on eBay and buy 3 copies of Platinum from one single seller and distribute them to their friends so that we could all do a Nuzlocke together? That hypothetically absolutely speaking, did not never happen.
Mm-mm. And they definitely did not have any issues running and all that, you know?
I will say that after dumping that ROM off of that cartridge onto my 3DS, like dumping the physical ROM is fine. It's definitely a cheap cartridge. That's definitely the problem there. Not even going to lie.
Hypothetically,
you mean?
Oh, yeah. Hypothetically. Definitely.
This definitely did not happen to any or all of us.
Any or all.
I like that.
But yeah, I, you know, having done the pre-production meeting with all of you, I know where this conversation's headed. And our main topic for this Dig Dang episode is the ABK Microsoft acquisition, merger, purchase, swallowing.
Technically, I think they've said it's a merger, but honestly, it's an acquisition. Yeah. I think Activision Blizzard said it was a merger when they emailed their staff, but it's an acquisition because, you know, they're just going to get folded into Microsoft.
Right. I mean, Microsoft's definitely the bigger fish. Steve, would you like to kind of give us a summary of the situation as we know it so that you can catch me, Hoodin, and potentially even our audience up on the situation?
Yeah, sure.
No pressure.
From like the very beginning, or
I don't know, whatever context you think is necessary to kind of understand this conversation.
So a little almost a year ago, I think like a year and a month ago, Microsoft entered into an agreement to buy Activision Blizzard, I guess King also.
Yeah.
We call them
ABK sometimes. Activision ABK. Blizzard King.
Yeah. And so ABK is well known in the gaming industry for anyone who doesn't know, because maybe they don't play any of those games. Those are the owners and the creators of Call of Duty, World of Warcraft, mm-hmm. Overwatch,
Diablo,
and where the big mobile money is, Candy Crush.
Yeah, in the mobile sphere, it's Candy Crush, and then I think Call of Duty Mobile. I didn't even know
that. That's King. That's the king of ABK.
Oh.
Yeah. And so, so originally it looked like things were going fine, and then, you know, certain regulatory bodies said, hold on, we're going to want to take a bit more of a look at this.
Because that would be Microsoft, the owner of Xbox, purchasing Call of Duty, is basically how most people look at it.
Yeah. And so, you know, certain regulatory bodies were like, hold on, you know, like, would this be a monopoly? Is this concerning? And it didn't look like much. It just looked like, oh, yeah, that makes sense that people would want to look at it. But recently, you know, it looks like the brakes have been hard getting slammed on it, because I know that the EU, their regulatory body, said that they had a few recommendations.
I think it was the UK approval. Specifically, not the EU. Those are no longer the
it
same might
have been. I'll be honest. I am just a very American centric, thick headed guy. because I guess here's the hot take. I don't know the difference, and I'm don't care to.
so America brain, let's go.
Absolutely. Across the water. As the English would say, someone across the pond.
That's right.
Over there was unhappy about it. And so their recommendation was that if Xbox were to acquire Activision Blizzard King, that they had like three options, either the divestiture of Activision Blizzard, so they would only get King, the mobile part of ABK.
Which is the major moneymaker.
Yeah. Or they would either divest Activision Blizzard Activision or Blizzard.
Mm-hmm.
So either they would lose like Call of Duty and the IP associated with Activision, or they would lose Overwatch, Diablo,
World of Warcraft,
StarCraft, Hearthstone, all of that stuff associated with Blizzard.
Call of Duty.
But keep Call of Duty, yeah.
Basically, you can't King. Have all three.
Yeah, that's honestly the moral of this. Well, actually, one of the suggestions was only getting rid of Call of Duty.
True, yeah.
So, yeah, but it meant you can't have it all, was sort of the moral of the story. And all of this, I don't want to say because, but I think in large part to Sony very much so doing everything they can to stop the deal from happening. They have been very vocal and outspoken against it and the way it would harm, I think, competition or whatever. And then obviously Microsoft pushing back that they are definitely not the leaders in the gaming sphere, you know?
Yep.
At least not when you compare them to the likes of Nintendo and Sony.
And Sony themselves. Yep.
Yeah. And so recently, though, I think the most recent news was they were having a meeting between almost all of the, like, large gaming companies in I think, Brussels. Mm. A closed-door meeting, but stuff has leaked out. And basically, I had a thing here, actually. Basically, Take-Two Interactive, which are the people who make the NBA games,
mm-hmm.
2K games. They also make BioShock, I think. EA, everyone knows EA. Tencent, NVIDIA, Nintendo, Valve, and the CWA, which is the something workers association, but it's basically like the sort of the union, the spokesperson of like unions in America.
Oh, interesting.
Have all come out in favor of the acquisition. The workers union people being obviously in favor of it because they want Bobby Kotick out. And it looks like the only way that's going to happen is if they actually get bought out of it. There's a body that's actually going to sort of oversee and regulate what happens there. And then the other companies probably want it because it opens up, I think, some space for them to be able to get maybe partnerships with Sony or, you know, free up the market a little bit for them to step into.
No, for sure.
Probably would be my mm-hmm. guess. Yeah. I hope that was an okay summation.
How was that, Hoodin? I know I've kept up with this less than Steve, but more than you.
I mean, most people who already knew about it have kept up more than me because a lot of that, like 90% of that, was new information for me.
Yeah.
But I feel like I'm keeping up. That was good. I like that.
You got it. You understand the narrative?
Yes.
I want a vibe check from you, Hoodin. Give me a vibe check on all this.
What are like, your feelings? My personal vibe. I'm like, I thought you wanted me to vibe check the situation. Yeah. I was
like, you're a regulatory council now. Vibe check, quick. No. How does Hoodin feel about all this? What are some of his initial reactions?
As someone who does not do a lot of research into kind of like the work environments and how different companies kind of run their business.
You get that secondhand from me and Steve a lot. Yeah.
Yes. as a consumer of Microsoft products, I have a lot of expectations of them, and just kind of like I have whenever I see something come out from Microsoft or specifically like for the Xbox.
Yeah.
Like I have an idea of the quality that it's going to be and it matches it pretty consistently. So from when I heard about the whole acquisition / merger / whatever it is, I was kind of excited because it brought up a lot of opportunities for better practices for the consumer and for the actual workers.
Okay. So you think this is going to be good for consumers?
I think so, just because of how ABK has treated their consumers, especially as of late. I mean, we've talked about our feelings about Overwatch going free to play and things of that nature. And I'm sure most people know about Diablo Immortal, and just
sure
as someone who enjoys gaming, like that feels kind of icky.
And you think that'll be different under Microsoft?
In my mind, it allows the opportunity for it to be different. Granted, we didn't like, I think it was around the time that merger was happening. Overwatch 2 was announced, right? We knew Overwatch 2 was coming that year.
I think that timeline about matches up.
Okay, well, regardless, I didn't know that Overwatch 2 was going to be an update to Overwatch 1 and completely replace it.
I remember
I wasn't
going
to bring this up, but I mean, if you're already going. Yeah.
I was under the assumption that it was going to be released as a new game, and so I was like, I'm not super into it. I'm fine staying at Overwatch
1. I remember we were talking about like, adding Junker Queen 5v5, because like the first beta had come out or something like that. Mm-hmm. And you're like, I'm not really interested in trying the beta. I know we're going to lose a lot of player base, but I think I'm going to stick with Overwatch 1. And I went like, Hoodin.
No, you're not.
Oh, no,
what Hoodin. Are you talking about? I was very excited for the changes that they're going to make to Overwatch 1 and just kind of like how they were going to improve that feeling. That obviously changed with Overwatch 2 coming out and erasing Overwatch 1. Still very sad about that. I think it would be very cool, especially now in the free-to-play sphere. Like, if you look at Fortnite, they've had, I don't even know what the term is, but like they've had like skins brought in from other games, like Master Chief. They've had
crossovers
skins for like crossover, and thank you. Like they've had crossovers with stuff like that. Steve and I don't know if you've been there for many of them, but Steve and I often talk about how cool it would be to have a George from Halo Reach skin for Reinhardt.
Yeah,
where he uses a gravity hammer.
Yeah.
And then a Master Chief skin for Soldier, and then a cat skin for Ana, and like stuff like that.
Those
like
would be good.
That would be super cool.
Those would be good.
And a Emile skin for Reaper.
Yeah, but like the likelihood of that happening is very low.
Sure.
Unless that merger happens, and then the opportunities for even other games like what's another Xbox exclusive that
they could be a Forza car?
Yeah, like they could have a map of like a Forza map, and then you push a Forza car.
Well, but
or something like that.
But fun fact that actually I know Forza has added the Warthog a few times now as a car.
And then they have.
And then
they actually
Microsoft
had a Continue. I'll talk about it later.
Just Microsoft Flight Simulator added the Pelican.
Yes, it did. I mean, that was pretty big.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it was Forza Horizon 4. They had a whole Halo event where you hopped into a Warthog and there were like Covenant ships flying down and like shooting at you and like things exploding and other Warthogs flying around and you had to chase a Pelican that was flying in the air. Like it was a whole event they did, which was super cool.
That's way cool.
And like, I think that would be super exciting to have as a thing in Overwatch, but the likelihood of that happening is really low unless the merger happens. And then it could be very high along with any other Xbox games. Like the possibilities of cool things that I might be tempted to buy could be brought into the game.
Well, and I think too, just on this topic of not only just kind of like this mixing of games, but going back to originally sort of how we segued here with game preservation, I think it's cool because right now, especially the Activision part of ABK, you can even see it with Blizzard, is very much oriented towards current lucrative IPs. And if the IP is not IP being an intellectual property, and if it's not lucrative, you never hear from it again, right? Guitar Hero, never heard from it again. And that's under Activision. That's, you know, that's locked away. Kind of like back when Disney had their vault for movies. That's in the vault indefinitely. They have Hexen, which was originally made by, I believe, Raven Software and id together. And Raven Software is under Activision, and id Software, which was part of Bethesda, is now owned by Xbox. If those two reunite, we, you know, not that obviously the workers are still the same and stuff, but it could be kind of cool to let, you know, see a revival of Hexen, see revivals of Guitar Hero. Skylanders, I know, was popular for a while. You could see that. You can see a new Spyro game, new Crash Bandicoot games. Because I think one of the things that comes with, I think, the subscription service of gaming is also both the catalog going backwards, right, for game preservation, but also having diversity of the portfolio, right?
So yeah, definitely.
You don't want just one thing because who's going to subscribe for just one thing? You want the Crash Bandicoots, the Spyros, the Hexens, the Guitar Heroes, you know? And then, too, like, maybe you don't need people constantly churning out Guitar Heroes anymore, because if it's part of the subscription service, then maybe you can just roll in updates for it where you get new rights to or licenses for songs and things like that.
Make it like a Beat Saber type thing.
And so, I don't know. I like the idea mostly because I think there's a lot of potential. And, you know, it could still be consumer friendly. I think as long as games are always purchasable outright, I think, you know, it's going to be consumer friendly. I think you see the issues when things aren't outright purchasable, like a lot of the shows and stuff that come from like Netflix or Disney or things where the only way of doing it is subscribing. Because that means you only have one option. And to me, that feels like a monopoly versus, hey, you can just buy Guitar Hero if that's all you care about. Or, you know, if you are a fan of playing a multitude of games, you know, and trying things and seeing if you like them, you know, subscription service is probably the best way of doing it. For $15 for a month, you can, you know, test a lot of games, see if you like Hi-Fi Rush. Maybe you don't. At least, you know, now you're not dropping a bunch of money only to not play the game.
Yeah.
Yeah. We've found like 3 or 4 games through Game Pass that we never would have touched if it weren't That's for true. That. Being able to just try it out.
I still miss Astroneer a little bit.
Well, I've been thinking about getting it on Steam. Fun fact. Nothing against doing it on console. It's just nice to not have to pay both a Wi-Fi bill and then also to use the Wi-Fi. listen, I'll keep everything a stack here. Like, I'll call out things that I think are dumb and should change in gaming. And I'll call out things that I think can be good, show signs of being good, yeah. You know?
I've been hesitant, but I'm still hesitant when it comes to, oh boy, sorry, I don't know if that came through on Discord, but my knee definitely just popped in the middle of me talking. Oh. That's embarrassing. I think the thing that I'm hesitant about, that I've been hesitant about, is it could be really good for consumers, and there's a high likelihood that it's really awesome until it's not. I just know that, like, Microsoft as a company has a really long history of being really awesome and cool until they're not. And that, you know, kind of keeps me wary. But I think it was Bellular News that put out a video about Game Pass and indie developers specifically, and like those relationships, that makes me feel a little better about it. And them talking about, like, oh, I'll try to, like, bring up the video here or link it here or whatever the heck. Like, I'll do a thing in editing. But basically, the skinny of it was is that, like, Game Pass will offer developers, let's say for the sake of argument, like, 70 to 80% of what that game could probably earn in revenue to be on Game Pass. Because there's data that shows that for 12 months after you're on Game Pass, your sales go down. Now, when games first release, their sales are like the highest that they'll ever be when games first release. And being on Game Pass impacts that a little bit. Like, we don't have a clear, like, case study, you know, like a randomized clinical trial that shows just how much being on Game Pass depresses initial launch sales. But there is data from Xbox because it got functionally leaked by the regulatory body in the UK looking into this, because if a regulatory body for a government is looking into stuff, all that stuff is now public record. So Microsoft has had data showing that sales do decrease if a game is on Game Pass, but part of being on Game Pass is that they essentially purchase those rights from the developer. And so for a lot of indie studios, or for one of the indie studios that Bellular was covering, was that they're like, we absolutely took that check because that was, even though it was under what we could have earned by not being on Game Pass, by having that money now and for sure, I can put that money to work. I can pay my developers to start working on our next game now, instead of over the next 6 months once we have enough of that money to do something, if we have that money. So that's something that I think is really important. It's hard because now we're putting Microsoft in charge of the trickle-down economics of handing out enough money to developers to make their games. Which, well, like, I'm uncomfortable with is like a boiled down simplification of that relationship. But boy, oh boy, is it better than them not getting any of the money because they get completely drowned out on the, quote, digital marketplaces.
So, yeah, I'd love to jump in on this.
Oh, give it to me.
Yeah, it's funny. I think Hoodin and I, spoiler for any listeners, I basically have similar rants about just sort of these podcast, mini podcast sessions in our regular hangout
voice
call chat.
We do it all the time. That's the whole reason we did this podcast, is we're like, oh, we should just record these sometime.
Yeah, we should just put them out in the world, see if anyone, you know, if it touches home for anyone else, you know?
Yeah.
But what Hoodin and I had talked about, funnily enough, is, I guess, what Bellular News.
Yeah, like cellular, but Bellular.
Yeah. A little bit of a tongue twister for me. just what he talked about, where I think it's a double-edged sword, right? Where for indie studios, it gives you a guarantee of a certain amount of money.
Yeah.
Obviously, there's risk and reward to that, right? Maybe your game would have underperformed what the deal was for. Maybe it would have been a sleeper hit like Stray was, the cat game.
Oh, yeah. Wasn't that
everybody and their
PlayStation
mother wanted
exclusive?
To play it. Yeah, and Steam, but I think the Steam port was pretty bad.
Yes, yes.
That's from my understanding. And so, yeah, just that idea of... obviously, there's risk and reward, right? If your game would have been a sleeper hit, you know, you're going to miss out on profit there. If your game wasn't going to be, then, you know, you've guaranteed yourselves a good amount of money to work on the next project, to pay your developers and everything.
You still get money from your sales of the game, but just the number of people buying your game because they're able to just try it on Game Pass is a thing.
Yeah.
Just to clarify that for in case anyone in the audience was confused.
And but ultimately, I think two things here. If anyone actually starts trying to compete with Game Pass, and I mean trying to compete as in like on the same level of dropping games day and date, and going through the effort of finding indie IPs or, you know, putting their own third party IPs.
Because
you know,
PlayStation has a thing, but it's, like, not even close. Like, on paper, sure, it's a competitor to Game Pass, but, like, not really. We all know it's not.
Well, I think...
it's PlayStation Plus.
Something like that.
Yeah. Oh, I think PlayStation's issue, sorry to any PlayStation fanboys, is I think they are reluctantly getting dragged into it. And so their offerings feel very much like a kid who's getting dragged along. Like,
sure,
to
give grandma
to...
a hug type stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, of like, okay, well, we have to put something out to compete, right? We can't just do nothing. But they don't want to, you know?
Yeah.
And so I think unless, you know, something big happens, they're not going to really try. And so that being said, I think that's where, to your point about the weird feeling of leaving it to Microsoft to become sort of the trickle-down economics manager... I think if you actually get other players in the industry providing something good and comparable, I think that's right. Competition there is going to be what really drives things. I think right now we're in an awkward place where the way PlayStation wants to do it is just buying the rights to games almost and keeping it away.
Yeah.
Like what they do with Final Fantasy.
Purchasing a studio without purchasing a studio. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What they did with Deathloop and Ghostwire Tokyo from Bethesda before Bethesda got bought.
And what they do with Call of Duty DLC and... I didn't mean to bring up Call of Duty again. Sorry there.
No, and so, like, I guess, you know, if we're going to truly lean into capitalism here, right?
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I think for me, it falls into that idea of if you own a store, right, you get, I think the most common phrase that everyone knows is no shoes, no shirt, no service, right?
Sure,
you get
to
dictate it.
Yeah.
So if we're going to fall with that idea, the most logical way for anyone to dictate who can play what game is for it to be the owner of the game, right? Mm-hmm. And so... PlayStation, as of now, does not own Square Enix.
Right.
Right. And not to single out PlayStation, I feel this way about any studio that purchases or sort of licenses temporarily the rights to a game.
As an exclusive.
As an exclusive without owning the studio, yeah.
Yeah.
I feel the same way with Xbox when they do it with, I think they did it with Tunic.
I think you're right.
They don't own that studio, I don't think. And just now, I think you're seeing the game hit the Switch and PlayStation, I think. Or somewhat recently. And so, yeah, it's the same thing where it's like Final Fantasy. And I think it's worse, too, when the game has been on other platforms, right? Been multi-platform like Final Fantasy has. And then you go, oh, yeah, Final Fantasy 16, though, is only going to be on PlayStation. You know, ignoring PC, obviously.
Which, yeah, that's... We're not even going to get into the weirdness of them, like, making the also available on PC smaller and smaller text, and then the developer being like, who said it was going to be on PC? Like, without even getting into any of that. Yeah, totally.
I think ultimately, I guess my stance on it is, I think every game should be available on any platform, right? And if you're going to monopolize something, it should actually be relevant to your console. Either it runs the best, right? Because you are offering the best hardware. Or to PlayStation's credit, I've heard nothing but great things about the haptic feedback controller.
Sure, if there's so like a technology, a specific technology.
Yeah, like I think, okay, then maybe the game feels best there because it feels like you're pulling a bowstring, right? You feel more immersed in it. I think that should be the appeal.
Yeah.
That being said, it's obviously not happening. And if we're not going to do it, then the only way I logically see people being able to make console exclusives is if you own the rights to the game.
Yeah, if you
how own do you own the rights publisher. To a game?
Yeah,
you have to own it.
Yeah, so yeah, I think like what you were saying with like there needs to be a reason that it's stuck on a certain platform. Like, I'm just going to use Nintendo here as an example. Like, I would not have wanted their 3DS games to also be forced to be released on Xbox, because the game is developed for that like unique hardware, right? And that's not what any of us are talking about here. Like, oh, it has to be available on all platforms, but what if it just doesn't fit? Like, no, like, exactly. Like, that's kind of been Nintendo's whole gimmick for a long time. But
even here's a hot take, though. You know, I see plenty of people playing a lot of the traditional Pokemon games on PC. And so, though maybe DS you're right about it, it not maybe necessarily making sense to run on an Xbox just because of how it would look, maybe how you optimize it. But I'm like, I don't know. I still think, you know, at the very least.
It can definitely be ported. Communities find amazing ways to port that kind of stuff all the time. I'm just saying, I don't want the developers to be like, huh, well, we have to. Our hands are tied. And now they're compromising on the vision of the...
You mean like putting Call of Duty on the Wii?
I don't think they compromised anything there. That looked awesome. That looked so fun to play. We've pretty well summarized, I know, like mine and Steve's kind of thoughts and feelings on it. Yeah. Hoodin, final vibe check on kind of all of this.
I mean, I don't know. Me personally, I think it can lead to good things, especially because in recent years, I haven't heard any like, people at Microsoft are being bad to their coworkers, and you know,
don't get me wrong, it's happening everywhere, but like that fair housing. Oh God, what's the regulatory body? California Fair Housing and Employment or whatever the heck, suing ABK twice.
Yeah, like, I haven't seen Microsoft be sued for anything
employment-related.
At least as recent as ABK has. So, like, in my head, some of those issues could be helped. Just because if it doesn't happen there, then maybe it won't happen if they get moved over.
Potentially.
I'm not a business expert or anything of that sort. That's just kind of how it works in my head. I don't know. I would be excited for that. I feel like a bad house with a good owner can be made into a good house.
Sure. You know, my pie in the sky dream is that they all turn into worker co-ops anyway. But anyway, I think that'll probably be a good place to end our main segment. And I don't know, what do you guys think? Do you guys have anything else that you just need to share before we move on?
Yeah, I'd like to tack on to the end of what Hoodin said.
Please do.
Yeah.
Real quick, I think I can speak confidently for all of us. Feel free to chime in if you don't agree.
Yeah.
to Hoodin's point, that's not to say, you know, to emphasize, I guess, Hoodin's point of, without going in depth on a whole nother thing, Not okay with the layoffs that happened at Microsoft recently.
True.
Yes, acknowledging that and calling that out and their own issues, right, of people at the top not getting their pay cut or anything in relation to having to lay people off.
Like, and all the issues with Halo. And
so to acknowledge that, at the silver lining, I think, being the emphasis of there has, at least I, to my knowledge, haven't heard of any huge and repeated sexual
misconduct
that just consistently happening. And you know what I mean? Not to say there isn't anything or anything that will come out in the future, but just acknowledging that as of right now, it looks like there's a little bit better. Maybe a little bit is being generous. So just it seems like there is just better management and sort of HR and everything regulation happening within Microsoft, which I think would be ultimately better for the workers, not layoff wise. Totally. Right. Like acknowledging that that's always going to be a risk after what we saw recently with Microsoft, which, you know, it's terrible and not OK, but also a separate issue that. You know, hey, if you guys want to hear us and our thoughts on it, you know, let us know in the comment section and maybe we can make that the main topic of the next one.
We're happy to take kind of discussions from the topics from the comment section. Totally.
We're happy to crap on any corporation however we can.
We're the ones with the microphones, goddammit. Yeah, awesome. Then I think if we're ready to wrap it up, I think it's time to listen to Steve talk about a game that's important to him. We take the end of this podcast as a time to share with you guys, the audience, games that we care a lot about to kind of give you guys a better sense of our gaming tastes so that as we talk in the future, potentially as we talk about new games or games that we're experiencing for the first time and our thoughts on it, you have a little bit of context for what we've been playing, what we've been playing historically, kind of our thoughts and feelings and our likes and dislikes kind of in that whole context web. So I want to let Steve talk to us about Splinter Cell, and he has 4 minutes on the clock. How does that sound, Hoodin?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, phenomenal. Let me get the stopwatch out. And whenever you are ready, Steve.
All right. Let me wait for a good little moment here on my clock. All right. So Splinter Cell, you know, developed, made by a small indie studio known as Ubisoft. I think technically pronounced Ubisoft. Typically, I prefer, I would rather prefer acknowledging small indie dev games or, you know, hole in the wall kind of games. But as of right now, I think giving some perspective on maybe my background, our backgrounds, our gaming background recommendations is kind of maybe nice for people to understand. So anyways, that being said, I love the Splinter Cell franchise. Played since the first Splinter Cell. I think the only one I missed was Splinter Cell Blacklist. I never played that one. Not to say I won't, just haven't yet. but the one I'd like to focus in on is Splinter Cell Conviction, because I think that's where one of the most recent ones that I always go back to playing. If you have the opportunity, Splinter Cell Blacklist is a phenomenal game to play. I think they unfortunately closed down the co-op servers, and it has a terrible PC port. So if you are able to get that on a console like PlayStation or Xbox, I think the campaign is very much well worth it. And you can play the co-op alone. It's just going to be a little tougher, you know, because it's meant for two people. What was that?
The co-op alone, like couch co-op?
It does have couch co-op. Yeah, that's how me and my brothers played it back in the day. Yeah, a phenomenal experience if you do it that way. It's such a good game, well developed. It's a great game. I think it's a great game too for first people kind of sinking their toes into a stealth third person action shooter game. It's great because it allows you to be not get punished for not being stealthy. You know, like you can be kind of loud and make mistakes in that game. In the original games, it was very much more stealth oriented. and sort of punished you for not doing that. So I think conviction is very fun. I think the interactions and the sort of cutscenes they have are very well done, in that you can really make those scenes and those moments your own, and it really pulls you into the world well for that. I forced Hoodin to play the co-op with me, and that was quite the setup. But Hoodin, I've got a minute here, and I'd like to share it. Okay. Give that to you.
So I will agree with Steve in that the multiplayer, like, you do have to jump through some hoops to get multiplayer working on a computer, and the PC port is kind of abysmal. At least from what I've heard about Steve talking about how it was on console, because I never played it on console. But as far as, like, third-person stealth games go, absolutely phenomenal. I enjoyed every second of playing the co-op with him, and then I went back and I played the campaign by myself.
Oh, wow.
And I also went and got Blacklist and started to play through that. Like, I am not much of a stealth game kind of guy. Like, I've tried playing Thief and
Dishonored recently.
Yeah, I tried playing Dishonored because that was the free game on the Epic Game Store. They're just not my thing. I am very much a run and gun type of player, and that game does a really good job of making stealth feel like you're moving quickly.
Nice. That's some good stuff.
There you go, a satisfied customer, if I've ever heard one myself. So yeah, I recommend giving it a chance. It goes on sale pretty frequently, on console for like $5, and on PC, I think, for like $10. So if you have a chance, you know, you should do that. If you do get it on PC and you have some struggles setting it up and things like that, you know, drop it in the comment section. Maybe able to help you there.
The Steam community and just basic Google searches, like those were very helpful.
You might even be able to ask ChatGPT to help you out. Unironically, like, that's not even a joke. You might be able to pull it off. But well done keeping it within the 4 minutes. This is not part of the 4 minutes. Does it have Steam remote play anywhere?
Oh, I doubt it.
No, because unfortunately, the way it works through Steam is if you buy it through Steam, all it does is give it to you through Uplay or whatever it is, Uconnect.
Yeah, it's like Titanfall.
So, yeah, it does not.
Boo.
I'm telling you, though, hey, if you've got a console, you know, it can still serve some purpose. If you've got, like, a PlayStation 3, 4... the PlayStation 3 store might be closed, so don't quote me on that, but...
You can get a disc.
Oh, yeah. True. Could get a disc.
Get a disc.
That's great. Dude. And as there is a deficit of good couch co-op games...
Oh, man.
That could work really well.
It's a very good one.
Without getting all the way into it, Hayden and I lived together for a long time, but especially my third year of college, I was living with my parents again, and it was a real task to find good couch co-op games for us to play, because we really like to play couch co-op games. But I think that was a really, really good episode. I like that we've got like two topics. I think we did that well.
Two distinct episodes mushed into one.
If we didn't have like intros and outros that are like not canned, then I would say I'd split it into two. But we're a little.
Should I stop my recording?
No. We're still going.
Okay.
Yeah. Another behind the curtains.
Maybe, all right. Maybe couch co-op games and that kind of stuff will be the topic for next session.
Oh, I'll put it in the doc. Anyway, thank you so much for joining us. This has been Thumbsticks Presents The Game Corner. With me, Maddie. You can find me under my channel, Athena. It's got a bunch of numbers and stuff, but I'm going to be streaming Overwatch and stuff there, and putting other videos about my thoughts and gaming related things. Anyway, that's me. I'm plugging that now, officially.
Nice.
You can find me there. I'll link
Very
it.
Cool.
Go find her there. Recommend it. Phenomenal person.
I am Hoodin. You can find Athena at her plugs. I have nothing to plug at the moment. I simply do not exist outside of these recordings. So good luck finding me.
That's good.
We dust you off for these.
It's a game. Don't challenge them to find you. Well, I'm Steve. I also don't have any socials or anything to link at the moment. But as Hoodin so eloquently put, you can find Athena, Maddie, at her Athena YouTube channel. Highly recommend. Go enjoy there. Maybe sometimes we'll pop in occasionally or something. Who knows?
Yeah.
You could know if you're there.
I have a feeling you two will be making cameos, especially during my streams. But I have one video up there right now, so go ahead and give it a watch.
It's a great video.
It's not a great video. It's really not.
It's a fantastic video.
No, don't overhype it.
Times already.
No, in the whole world.
No, we're getting out of here.
I put it on loop just to hear her.
Oh, God. Thank you. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Peace out.